The man in the middle with glasses, Richard Alpert, one of the two Americans most often blamed or praised for the psychedelic revolution.
My reaction to being the two nights at Foothill College were that I've had, as I say, LSD over 300 times, and by the end of those two nights, it was like going to two horror movies. I was so scared, I didn't know whether I'd ever be able to take LSD again. It really reminded me of four guys up there on the lecture platform, all of whom had had bad sessions and bad reentries and had this terrible view of the whole world, you know, and all they could see were the problems and the fears for society, but none of the potential, none of the positive questions about what is man to do next and what opportunity might LSD hold. They're not even interested in that. They are so committed to the fact that this society is the way it is, and that's all you can expect. And that's what I'd call vested interest in the ongoing game. And if you have vested interest in the ongoing game, you are frightened by anything that might change it.
How did we get hung up this way? Because it's a social condition, you'd agree.
How did we get hung up this way? How did man get into this kind of cultural limits
yes,
of this
this incredible moment? Assumption that society is as it is and has always been this way.
Well,
because that makes no sense at all the moment you say it, and yet people behave as if that were true.
Well, it's just like, for example, I was at a lecture the other day of Buckminster Fuller, and who's doing your dome for the World's Fair, I think, up in Canada. And he said, look, we now know there is enough to go around, all right? In other words, if we could truly collaborate with our fellow man, there would be enough to go around for the world. But none of us can break through our own models of the way the game goes enough to do the things necessary to bring about that realization. And it's only when there is enough that we can become back to we, both of us as subject, and experience the unity when we are truly collaborative about our resources. And man has come out of the jungle where there wasn't enough and where he fought for it, and he's built a whole ethic around not having enough. And now to be able to really shift that ethic is a very, you know, and the whole motivational pattern connected with it is a very difficult thing for him to do.
I'm reminded of a slogan or two I saw some students carrying once. One said, all wars are civil wars because all men are brothers. Right. And another one said, there is no they.
Right, exactly. And that's one of the components of the LSD experience, the understanding that there is no they. There's no other. It is all one. And it's really, what happens here is, there are a lot of experiments in psychology with figure ground. That is the relation of the background to what stands out, right? Now, in our culture, we've been trained for individual differences to stand out. So you look at each person, the immediate hit is brighter, dumber, older, younger, richer, poorer, and we make all these dimensional distinctions, put them in categories, and treat them that way. And we get so that we only see others as separate from ourselves in the ways in which they're separate. And one of the dramatic characteristics of the psychedelic experience is being with another person and suddenly seeing the ways in which they are like you, not different from you, and experiencing the fact, well, yes, indeed, we are brothers in the true sense of that which is essence in you and which is essence in me is indeed one.
What's this do to the free enterprise market system?
Well, what it does, if I understand it right, is it moves the basic motivation from an achievement competitive to a collaborative kind of enterprise, which means that I'm not working in order to beat you out, but you and I are working in order to both make it. Now, at this point, we're still, I'm aware that you're a separate individual from me. We're separate, but there's something similar, right? Now, at this point, there is this start to break down of the separation, the separation between us. For example, I might look down, and this is an external hallucination, I will see my body disappear, right? Or see those ways in which I am different become like learned things that I wear, like this sweater. For example, PhD, what does that mean? All right, it means I got a certain kind of education, acquired a certain degree for being more educated than 0.1% of the world's population, something like that, all right? And that assures me of something or other in society, all right? In fact, it's a garb I wear. If I had the gown and the cap, you know, that would be the external symbol of that same thing, right? Now, that gown is a psychological gown I wear, just like Richard Alpert is a gown I wear. You know, it's an identity that I've taken on. I wasn't born Richard Alpert. I was just born as a human being. And then I learned this whole business of who I am and whether I'm good or bad or achieving or not. All that's learned along the way. And you see all those learned things separate, so you start to have this dissociative experience of where all that you become is awareness, is a point of awareness. That's all that's left. And I remember the first time this happened to me, as professor went and middle class boy went and pilot went and all of my games were like going off into the distance, I got this terrible panic because indeed I was going to cease to exist. And I got the panic, which is the panic that precedes the psychological death, because indeed Richard Alpert was dying at that point. And the panic was, no, stop, stop, I've got to hold on to something so I'll know who I am. And Timothy, the wise old Timothy, always says things like, trust your nervous system.